so yesterday we at the end of the class we were looking at the problem of how do we compute the cumulative sum of a set of numbers, right? So the numbers that you are given are a1 up to a8, for example, in general up to an, okay, and you are asked to compute a1, a1 plus a2, a1 plus a2 plus a3, and so on up to a1 plus a2 up to a8. Okay, this is known as the cumulative sum or the running sum, right, as we go through the set of numbers. Now, of course, if you want to do this in series, then the way that you would do it would be, I will calculate a1 plus a2, take the result, add a3, add a4, up to a8, and each and every one of these would be one of the results that is required. Right? And we know already that the length of this is proportional to n, which is the number of values to be added. Okay? We also saw that if we have a very specific problem of a1 to a8 only, this alone, then we would do it in a slightly different way. What we would do is add a1 and a2, add a3 and a4, a5, a6, a7, a8, add these two together, and finally this gives us the summation that we want. Okay? And the depth of this architecture, the number of stages, how much is it going to be? For n in general, log n to base 2, because at every stage you are reducing by the number of values to be added by a factor of 2. So after how many stages will the final output become just one output after log n stage, right? It's doubling at each stage, or rather halving at each stage. In general, if n is not a power of 2, then it will be the closest integer that is larger than n, then log n to base 2. Okay? So now we would like to use this type of architecture, get that benefit of the log n kind of computation, but for the complete prefix computation. This, what you have called over here, is the cumulative sum, or also called the prefix sum. Right? A1, A1 plus A2, A1 plus A2 plus A3, etc. are called prefixes of the final sum, which is A1 up to A8. Okay? And what you would like to do is get something which exploits that logarithmic growth in complexity in order to compute all of that final value, the final sum. Okay? The problem is, it's not just one sum that you are trying to compute, it is 8 different sums that you need to compute. So you need to make sure that somehow all the different values are being computed properly over here. Okay? So the way that is used for that is to say, I'll draw it out completely for the case of 8, and we sort of think about how it can be generalized beyond that. One other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put A8 at the left and A1 at the right, because that sort of brings us closer to the structure which is used for the addition. In addition also the same thing is being done. Why is this similar to addition? Because in addition, instead of the cumulative sum of values, what I want to do is find out the carry propagation. The carry propagation has the same kind of property. Right? So in fact, for this prefix sum computation can be done for any function f which satisfies the associative property. Right? And we want to compute f of f of S. Nested computation of the function. Okay, the same kind of approach can be used because ultimately this is what we want to find out. We want to find out f of n, f of n, f of n, and so on. Okay. The approach that we are going to follow is somewhat the same. The first thing, of course, is that one of the results, A1, is directly available to us. Okay? A2 2:1 essentially indicates the sum from 1 up to 2. Okay? So A2:1 is also available to us directly over here. Right? So what we are going to do is similar to what we used in the case of the parallel addition for getting one single sum. We will also go ahead and compute these other values. A 4:3. Right now, 4:3 by itself is not useful. That only tells us the sum of 3 and 4. What we want is the sum of 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so 4:3 by itself is not useful. This is 6:5 and 8:7. Okay. Now in the second stage, this is stage 1. Right? Where essentially what we are saying is all the operations are take the adjacent value, or rather take take something on the form 2i minus 1 and 2i and combine them together. Okay? So things that are separated by unit distance are combined 2 at a time. In the next stage, we combine things that are 2 apart. So we take this and we get a 4:1. We take this and we get 8:5. Okay. Now we could have also combined 3 with 2:1 over here. We don't do that at this stage because we want to keep each stage, the computations at each stage, to be precisely identical. Okay. The reason for doing this is because when you are writing a parallel program, in order to do this, you want to make sure that everything which is being done in one stage of computation is a single kind of operation. Okay, so if I am writing a for loop, all that I need to do is over here, I can say the second for loop takes things which are stage 2 apart and adds them together. So then I don't have to put a special condition for 3 with 2:1 and so on. That will be taken care of later. Okay, stage 3 combines things that are 4 apart. In this case, there is only one example over here. This gives us 8:1. Okay? This is stage 3. In stage 4, I am going to take the 6:5 and combine it with 4:1. That is to say, I am going to take the things that are 2 apart over here, but which were not computed earlier. So two things were not earlier computed, right? If I look at the things that were two apart, this was somewhere in the middle, so I did not have anything computed earlier. This alone is done in phase 4, 6:1. Okay? And then I go ahead and compute the remaining things, namely 7:1. And 3:1. Okay. Now if you look at it, everything has been taken care of. I have 8:1 over here. 7:1 over here, 6:1, 5:1, 4, 3, 2, and of course, A1 extra. Okay? All the sums that I needed have been computed in this manner. Okay? The regularity of the structure is important. Look at it. At each stage, either I am adding two things that are one apart, or two apart, or four apart. I am not mixing things together. So I have a clear separation between stages and I can clearly tell you at each stage what is the computation to be done. Okay? This kind of a structure makes it easy to program. That is to write a program in order, write a parallel program in order to do this. In our case, we are not interested in a parallel program, so there may be some optimization further that we can do in terms of the architecture itself. Okay? Now this overall process that we have over here is called a reduction operation. Okay? It's also sometimes called a scan operation in parallel computing. A prefix scan. Okay? For those of you who might have heard of the term MapReduce in terms of parallel computing, right? It's Google's approach to parallel computing and is essentially considered a very powerful way of scaling across large number of processing elements. MapReduce is based on this idea. Okay? So, what we have over here is a way by which I can compute the prefix sum ai:1 for all I from 2 to 8. Right? In an efficient manner. Why efficient? Because the total number of stages is proportional to log n. It is not exactly log n, it is 2 log n actually in this case. Right? In this particular case, 2 log n minus 1 is what you need. Right? But it is going to be proportional to log n. So approximately 2 log n stages is what you are going to need. Right? So now comes the question, can we make use of this in order to compute what we need for addition? Right? Over there, what is the function that we are trying to compute? G i:j. We know it can be written in terms of i:k in this case, right? So there is something like a summation operation that needs to get implemented over there also. And ultimately, the carry out at the ith stage is just simply, was there a carry generated between stage 0 and from stage 0 to stage i for the block? Carry generated by the block zero to one. Okay? So this is the entire block that we are considering. We are not interested in any individual element over here. We want to know if there is a carry being generated out of that entire block. If so, that is the carry out of that block. Okay. So this is somewhat similar to the prefix computation that we had, because the first carry is generated by the first stage. The second carry is either carry generated at the second stage or generated at the first stage and propagated through. Third carry is either generated at the third stage or generated at second stage, propagated, or generated at first stage, propagated through both. So the kind of computation is very similar in nature to what you need to do for the prefix sum. Okay? Which means it may be possible to build an architecture for addition where the carries get generated using this prefix sum type of architecture, and the entire depth, the logic depth that you require is log n stage instead of n stage, or even square root of n. The best that you have seen so far is square root of n, remember, for the carry select and carry bypass adder. Right? Ripple carry, of course, is proportional to n itself. Carry select and carry bypass with variable length block can become square root of n. But log n is a whole different story. That's a considerably more efficient structure in terms of the logic depth. It can become quite big when you go to 64-bit or 128-bit adder. Okay? So, what does the architecture of such a thing look like? The first one is called the branch-trunk adder. All of these adders are named after the people who discovered them. In this case, two people, Brent and Tom, were the ones who first proposed this adder structure. This is named after them. Okay? Look at the structure. Hopefully, this will remind you of the parallel prefix computation that we were talking about just now. Right? At each stage, what's happening? We essentially have this kind of computation. Right? Reduction. The first stage involves reduction by a factor of 2 adjacent stages. The second stage involves reduction with stages that are stage 2 apart. Third stage in this case, 4 apart. And then finally, there is one stage 4 which is 8 apart. Right? Only one computation at that fourth stage. After that, you have the second half, right? Just like we saw in the case of the parallel prefix sum, stage 5, 6, and 7. Right? Log n to base 2 for 16 is 4. Right? So 2 into log n, 8 stages. 8 minus 1, 7 stages is what you have over there in terms of the computation. What are the actual computations that are taking place? Pay attention to the fact that there are grey blocks as well as black colored boxes over here. Right? The black boxes are responsible for computing, for example, 3:2. They generate both the G and the P values for that entire block. So they can be combined along with the previous G values in order to give this. The 3:0 and so on. Okay? So the black values, so this one for example does 5:4, this one does 7:6. This combines both of those in order to give 7:4. Okay? And finally, this combines everything up to there to give 7:0. Right? In the second part, we have the 5:0, 9:0, 13:0. 11:0, all of those are computed separately in the second part, in the downstream portion of the prefix sum computation. Okay? Now, are there any, so obviously you can see that the one big advantage as far as this structure is concerned is what? What is the main reason why you would go for this kind of architecture? Huh? Why did we look at the parallel prefix term computation at all? No? Logic depth, the number of cases. Right? The main reason why you want to go for any of these things, so all the adders that you are going to see from now on are so called tree adders. Right? They essentially have different ways of implementing that reduction tree. Okay? Start with a large number of elements and reduce it down to one. Okay? Brent-Long is the first of the tree adders that you can look at. It is directly implementing the parallel prefix sum computation. Okay? So in this case, what happens is the advantage is log n stages, proportional to log n stages, 2 log n stages. Okay, is what it has. Are there any disadvantages that you can think of? Is 2 log n really the best that you can do? Can you do better than that? Looking at this picture, what does it look like? Can you reduce it to less than 2 log n? Okay, so the thing is, yes, you can reduce it to less than 2 log n, right? In fact, you can probably aim for log n itself. Beyond log n, as we'll see later, looks very difficult. Okay, reducing it below log n. Now, why do we see that we can reduce it below log n? Look at this picture, there are a large number of empty states where there are no computations being performed, right? It's just the signal is being fed through those blocks. Okay? So if that is the case, then essentially it may be possible to sort of compact this, right? Reduce the number of levels that we have by sharing some computations in between other states. Okay. So ultimately that is the next goal. Is there any way by which we can reduce this? Okay. Apart from that, the one thing you would notice is one advantage of having so many gaps and so much space is that I can nicely use buffers all over the place. Right? So for example, this signal over here, right, it needs to go to this, to and to this, okay. So that's okay, that's actually only 2, right. But look at this signal for example, it needs to go over here, it needs to go over here, and it needs to go here. So technically speaking, it would have had a fan out of 3, except that because of all those gaps that I have over here, I am able to put buffer. Okay? The fan out in this case can be restricted to a maximum of 2. One on the critical path, one to a buffer, which then takes care of feeding everything else. Okay? So that gives us the clue about what we can do in order to get to the next kind of adder, right? Where the number of logic stages is reduced, or the logic depth is reduced. Okay? Look at this, it's a much more busy adder structure. Busy in the sense that lots more things happening in less space. Right? But you look carefully at it, pretty much the same thing is happening here as well. As in the Brent-Long adder. The one difference, if you look carefully, is things like this. Okay? Those extra black boxes that are circled over there were not there in the case of the Brent-Long adder. What are those black boxes doing? They are doing some additional computation. So, for example, they are making sure that you pre-compute and keep ready the G and T values for 11:8. 13:8, 14:8, 15:8, and so on. Right? What's the advantage of doing something like that? As and when the carry signal becomes ready, it can be fanned out at once to all the signals that I have. Okay? So, this structure structure that we have is called as Planckian adder. Once again named after the adder. Okay. Number of stages. How many stages does it have? Lot. Okay. But what's the problem? Okay, it achieves that log n stages instead of 2 log n by allowing increased fan out for certain signals. Okay, now it becomes a question of which one is worse. Is it better to have fewer logic stages but higher fan out at each stage, or is it better to have larger number of logic stages but the fan out that is restricted to a maximum of 2? How do you answer that? In general, there's no way of doing it. You have to be able to do some computations involving logical effort in order to find out what's the right answer. Okay? So logical effort can actually help you to answer this question, but then it depends on some, you need some additional knowledge of what are the sizes of the gates that are being used. Okay? What is the input capacitance of the entire adder? What is the output capacitance that it needs to drive? Based on that, you will choose the overall sizes of the intermediate stages. Okay, and that in turn will also tell you whether or not having a large fan out is going to be a problem or not. Right? You can do some computations based on the total load capacitance in order to estimate whether or not this Planckian adder will make more sense than the Brent-Cohn adder. Okay. So it has high fan out, which is a problem. Right? So in order to combat that, there is yet another adder structure that exists. Once again, looks like a very busy adder. Lots of computational blocks. Right? Look carefully at it. What is happening is, we are saying that instead of doing that reduction by 2, then reduction by 4, reduction by 8, at every stage we just put in the PG black boxes so that they generate the propagate and generate signals for all the combinations 4:1, 5:2, 6:3, 7:4, everything, and then use those in order to raise. Okay, the important point is that now by sort of as soon as I generate the carry in the first stage carry 0, I can then propagate it out to a large number of other stages and straight away from there do the other computations that I need. Okay? This structure is known as the COG store adder. Right? The COG store. I'm not sure the exact pronunciation. COG store adder. Okay? What is the COGSTONE adder do? Once again, it's based on a similar idea. Reduction. Right? First stage you have reduction by 2, things that are adjacent to each other. Then things that are 2 apart, then 4 apart, 8 apart, and so on. Okay? Except that in this case, all the computations, not just the minimum number of computations that need to be done, are done ahead of time. Right? So if you look at the number of units that are present over there, it's quite a large number of those black boxes that you need. Okay? But the black box itself, you know what the complexity is. It's not something very large, right? An individual black box essentially looks like this, right? The black box and the gray box. So it's not that the black box and the gray box are very complicated structures. They are fairly simple to implement. It's just that you need a larger number of them for the COGSTONE adder. Right? Even when compared to the Planckian adder. Okay? But compared to Clancy, what's the advantage of Costco? Thanos. What is the disadvantage of Clancy? Thanos. What's the Thanos over here? Two. We are once again back to two. Okay? So we have once again changed the Thanos that is required at each stage back to two. But what's the drawback? Apart from the fact that there are more black boxes required. No, four stages is fine. I mean, so that's log n stage. That's the same as plan stage. It doesn't look like we can do better than that. More power, right. Okay, marginally so. So that's also possibly a point. But let's not talk about power yet. Because power has other considerations also in terms of what and all is toggling and so on. Okay? Power could be an issue because the number of black boxes is larger. But even that is may or may not be a problem. If we stick to the problem of delay alone, is there anything, any drawback that you can see as far as this adder structure is concerned? Wiring, long wires. Right? You need wires that can reach all the way across from one end to the other. Look at the other architecture. They had relatively few wires. Right? So Clancy had like one wire which needed to go halfway across the adder and it taps essentially for the other. Right? So it could be one wire which is essentially tapped off into multiple places. Brennstone did not even need that. There is one wire over here which goes from 7:0 to 15:8, but that's it, it's a single wire. Compare that with Cordstone. The number of wires that need to go halfway across the full adder is pretty large. It's half the number of things. Okay? So there are a large number of long wires that are required for this. And as we go to smaller and smaller technology, right? We didn't see specific numerical examples, but the whole problem of Elmore delay and why we consider that essentially told us that wiring is becoming a problem. Or rather, wiring is a problem already. Right? At this point, wiring is a major problem. It can contribute a very significant chunk of your overall delay. Okay? So in this case, we have long wires and those wires themselves could have significant R and C, which means delay associated with them. And as a result, they are also loading, they could also contribute to the power consumption. Okay, but first order is delay. Right? They definitely impact the delay of the overall structure. Right? So this one once again has log n to base 2 stages. Fanout equal to 2. But long wire. Okay. Now, if you go to the textbook, look it up over there are a whole bunch of other related adders that you can find. Right? And in fact, the textbook has a nice sort of classification of all the different kinds of adders. It turns out that by having some metric which is based on the Thanos, the number of stages, and one other parameter, I'm not forget it. It's possible to actually build up a classification of different kinds of adders. All these adders are so-called tree adders. Why are they tree adders? Because they essentially construct some kind of a tree to calculate the final carry out in terms of the previous values that are there. Okay? So this classification of tree adders can be used in order to essentially find out what are the different sort of pluses and minuses of different adder architectures. Okay? So that part I'm not going to cover in class. You can look it up in the textbook in Basic Industries and Westray and Harris. Right? There's a very nice classification of a large number of different kinds of adders that is present over there. Okay? We will conclude our discussion of adders at this point. What we have done is basically looked at three different kinds of tree adders, the Brennstone adder, the Clancy adder, and the Cordstone adder. Right? How do they work? They all work by the principle of sort of successive reduction, pairwise reduction, right? Which means that they are going to finish their work, their addition, in something proportional to log n stages. But whether it is going to be log n or 2 log n, and whether you have high fan out, low fan out, long wires, all of that depends on the details of the architecture that you use. Okay, any questions? Yeah. Yes. Making it shorter. How? So that's the question. In general, it has been found that because of these long wires in the schematic, even in the layout, you are going to require the same kind of long wires because you have to place those cells at some distance. See, the problem is you could have done something for something like Brenskung or Plansky. You could have done something to reduce the number, the sort of length of the wire. Problem in Topstone is the number of wires that are long, or the number of wires that are going across large distances. If you make one of these wires shorter, some other wire will become longer to compensate. Right? So in general, it's not possible to shorten all of them. That's the problem. Okay. So this has been studied in the past. People have looked at it and tried to find out what is the best layout and so on. There is no simple way of reducing the overall length required for the wires in this. Right? So you are right. I mean, it's one thing to look at a schematic and say that these are long wires. Then you go to layout, they may not be, need to be as long as they look on the schematic. Or the other problem may also happen. Something which looks like it's very close over here in the schematic may end up being a fairly long wire in the layout. Both problems can happen. Right? So as you pointed out, the important thing is the actual estimation of wire length has to be done at the layout level, not at the schematic level. Okay. This is what I mean by schematic, where you are just drawing boxes and wires connecting them. Layout is, which actually corresponds to the silicon area. Okay. So the correct way of estimating wire length is to go to layout. Okay. What we are saying is in Topstone, because of the large number of wires that need to connect things that are far apart in the schematic, even if you somehow manage to reduce the length for a few of them, that will end up increasing the length for some other thing. Okay? So for example, if I move this way, the 15:8 and 7:0 a bit closer together, that will mean that the 7:0 will move away from either 7:4 or 3:0. So those wire lengths will increase. Right? And because of the number of such cases that you have, it's not possible to reduce all of them. You will always end up with some long wire. This cannot really be handled effectively. Okay? The other thing, of course, is there is also the question, in general, as far as layout is concerned, one of the things that you would really like to do is get all layouts to be as regular and clean as possible. What do I mean by regular? I would like to have one kind of cell which is just repeated n times and linked up together. Okay? Why is that a good thing? Two reasons. One is, it's easier to design. The second is, even the variations between them will be reduced, provided that you have all similar structures. Supposing one full adder occupies 1 square micron, whereas another full adder occupies 2 square microns, because of the way that you have designed them internally. Right? It's possible that if you try using both of them in the same design, you will end up with things that, you know, vary differently in different parts of the circuit. So from the point of view of regularity, matching different parts of the circuit together, also it's good to have a simple kind of structure which just gets repeated. Okay? Analog design especially, you would know that the whole idea of matching, having regular structures, is very important even for basic functionality. In digital design, you don't care all that much. You can have, as long as the digital functionality has been taken care of, you don't need to worry too much about the exact regularity of the structure. But the regularity is still important because of the sheer number of such modules that are being used. Okay? Yeah. You see? Yeah. Okay. Yes and no. So what happens is that if you design it with, so the question is, the propagate logic could also have been designed with A or B instead of A X or B, right? Because I could say that the carry is to be propagated if A or B is 1, right? In that case, when A and B are both 1, what is actually happening is both generate and propagate are equal to 1, okay? So I am generating a carry, and if a carry input came, I am propagating it also. Right? As such, there is no problem with that. It's not wrong. Okay? It's just that it sort of breaks this clean distinction between the generate and the propagate, and some of the computations that we are doing over here may actually go wrong. Okay? In some of the prefix computations that we are looking at. Actually, I need to check on that carefully. I am not sure if there will be a problem with the computation. But one of the reasons why we stick with A XOR B is that there are clever ways by which you can implement the XOR directly using pass transistors or other kind of logic, so that the XOR logic itself is not very complex. Okay? So once you design a cell, the propagate logic, and you optimize that, then you can directly use the PNG cells in order to implement the rest of the logic stated. Okay? But the point he is raising is an important one. Is there a simpler kind of logical function or equivalent that will allow you to reduce the complexity internally? That has been considered. People have looked at different kinds of adder architectures where that change has also been made. For the purpose of analysis and for study at least, we stick with XOR because it makes a clean separation between the generate and the propagate. But you can also look at what happens if I use propagate as A or B instead of A XOR. Similar kinds of results will hold. It will not change things too dramatically. Okay? Alright, so the core idea of addition, we have covered various kinds of adders that have to be done. Okay? Now we are moving towards the problem of multiplication, but before that there is one intermediate step, because multiplication in some sense is repeated addition, right? So definitely we are going to be using addition in the context of multiplication, right? Before getting into that, one of the things that we would like to answer is, what happens if I want to add many numbers together? Okay? So let's say that I have 4 numbers, all I'm going to consider these as unsigned numbers. Okay, don't worry about 2's complement and so on. These are all unsigned numbers right now. Okay? So I want to add these 3 numbers together. How would I do it? So add 2 of them, say x plus y, get the result, to that add z. Okay? Now, what is the delay going to be for that? Essentially it's going to be one adder over here, x, y, then another adder, z. Okay? So it's going to be 2 adder delay. Okay? Let's say that I wanted to add even more numbers together. Okay? X plus y plus z plus t. Then it will become effectively 3 adder structures that I need to implement. Okay? Now whether I do some kind of logarithmic grouping and so on is a different question. The point is, each of those adders is a complete adder by itself. Okay? So this has to be a full adder in a, you know, n bit adder. This has to be another n bit adder. Okay? But what I'm going to do instead is I'll do this computation in a slightly different way. Right? What I'll do is I'll take x plus y and create two outputs from it. Okay? One is the sum output. And the other is the carry output. Right? The carry at each stage. So the carry effectively, the first stage carry out of the first stage is 0, carry out of the second stage is 1, carry out of the third stage is 0, carry out of the fourth stage is 0. This is just using the numbers directly, not by actually propagating the carry. So there is no ripple carry path at all through this. Okay? Why have I put this dash over here and shifted the carry left? Because actually what is happening is those carry bits are effectively being added to the next position. Right? So the 1 and 1 that I had over here, when they get added and generate the carry, that carry actually adds to the bit position to the left of it. So I put the carry correspondingly over here. Okay? What's the advantage of this? Advantage is, I have now just taken a parallel sum and carry addition. There is no ripple at all. There is no carry propagation at all through this logic. Bit by bit I have done sum and carry. Okay? And generated two n bit outputs. Okay? To this I will add z. Okay. The problem is I still need to do a 3 input addition. So somehow I will need to be able to reduce this. So for adding 3 numbers, actually the example is pretty poor. It doesn't really convey exactly what it is that you are saying. Okay. But let's say that I was able to do this for some n numbers. This is n bit, this is n bit, okay? And I generate n bit carry, n bit sum. Okay? I then want to add that to x2, okay? I feed all 3 of these together into a adder. Okay, because an adder can take 3 inputs, A, B and carry in, and generate 2 outputs. Okay. If I wanted to add yet another value to this, I could have done x3, or rather this is x3 and this would be x4. Once again carry and sum, right? What is the logic delay through each of these stages? It's a single bit full adder delay. Not a ripple carry adder delay or even a Cogstone adder delay, because that is still log n stages. This is nothing, this is just unit delay. Okay? So what has happened is, these individual boxes that are shown over here are just basically taking numbers and sort of adding them up together 3 at a time. Of course, one mistake I made was I added just x1 and x2 together. I could have added x1, x2 and x3. Right? Taking x3 as the carry input instead to the same adder. Okay? It would have reduced to 2 at the end of that. Then add x4, once again reduce to 2. The problem is, at the end of the day, I don't want the sum and the carry separately. I want them to be combined together. So I will need one adder. This has to be a regular carry propagate adder. Okay? Each of these is called a carry save adder. Right? Why is it called a carry save adder? Because you are not doing the computation of the sum plus carry and generating a single carry out at one shot. You are generating the carry also as a vector, an n bit value, that still needs to be combined with the result. Okay? We'll stop here now. Tomorrow we'll see how exactly carry save adders can be used in the context of multiplication.